What I'm going to present today is a collection of results that I've, I guess my group has derived over the last few years thanks to the funding by Metrans, a couple of fundings from Metrans, and also was fortunate enough to get a couple of grants from NSF. So this is kind of an overview of the results that we have obtained so far. It's still an ongoing work. Being an overview of results, what I'm going to present today is work of my students. I see them, so if you could raise your hands. So if you have questions, these are the people to ask the questions, right? But seriously, I understand this is a diverse audience. So please feel free to interrupt me at any time if there are questions, okay? All right, so what I'm going to talk today is about urban traffic systems. And particularly in the context of emerging technological advancements, right? So there's one part of technological advancement which is getting more coverage, namely the autonomy and connectivity between vehicles. But the other side of technological advancement, which is probably not getting as much coverage as it should, is the eye-to-eye communication infrastructure, or infrastructure-to-infrastructure communication, right? So the left-hand side, the autonomy and connectivity will improve the V2V and V2I communication capabilities. But also we should keep in mind that the same underlying technological infrastructure can also facilitate eye-to-eye communication, right? So yes, you can improve congestion and safety by increasing autonomy, but the infrastructure is already ready for embedded connectivity within the infrastructure layer, right? So these are a couple of news clippings from not far ago. So Los Angeles, probably some of you have heard, invested a lot of money in synchronizing its traffic lights to improve urban traffic flow, millions of dollars. And US DOT, for example, chose San Diego as one of the testing grounds for integrated corridor management, again, 4 or 5 years ago, right? So Southern California is a testbed for many of these technologies that want to integrate various modes of transportation and improve reliability and efficiency, right? So from a scientific perspective, these are exciting because this bring new challenges from a control and optimization perspective, right? So as a traffic engineering faculty member, I look at this and I see lots of new knobs that I can turn in the system, right? So I can program the vehicles with car following behavior. I can choose who talks to whom. I can choose which signal will communicate with which. So there's this endless new possibilities now, which were not before, right? So it's clearly by exploiting such additional capability, I can improve the efficiency and reliability of transportation system. But because of the new possibilities, there's also a lot of complexity because all of a sudden the number of knobs that I can turn is huge, right? So how to do that in a nice formal manner? What are the tools that I need to use to do that in a real time? That's what I'm going to talk about, right? So I'm going to present some results which are suggestive in the direction of what kind of tools are quite relevant for this kind of problems. So there are several challenges in exploiting this new technology, but there are a few things which I'm going to particularly focus on today. There are a couple of things: the scale and the complexity of this traffic systems, right? So by scale, I mean the number of knobs that I can turn, the number of sensors that I present are just huge, right? So these are the pictures that I got from my colleagues at IMSC, who have also been affiliated with Metrans. So each of the dots here represents a loop detector sensor, right? So from which you can have real-time streaming of data. So this gives you, this is in some sense giving you capability for real-time health monitoring of traffic flow. So you have this data at your disposal coming at a very high frequency, and there are ramps, there are several ramps, hundreds of ramps, thousands of ramps in this greater Los Angeles area. There are thousands of intersections that you can tweak the green light. So imagine that you have thousands of sensors relaying information real time. You have to process that information and then decide what should be the ramp meter schedule, what should be the green time schedule of traffic lights. So it's a very complex optimization problem, right? So scalability is an issue. So either you have big computers do all the calculations in one place, or you can parallelize the computations at several locations and have those parallel clusters communicate with each other, right? So complexity is, by complexity I mean the models that we are going to use for our optimization purpose classically have been derived or have been built for human-driven vehicles, right? So, but when you have autonomous vehicles, one could even question the validity of traffic flow models, right? So all of a sudden, the complexity of model itself increases. So you have this large-scale control or optimization that you have to do on an increasingly complex class of models. How do you tame this complexity, right? So what I'm going to present are some results. Now, there's one important aspect that I won't have time to discuss today, but something that we have worked on and we are continuing to work is on the social aspect. So this new technology will influence driver behavior, right, in terms of what routes they take and on the longer term where they choose to live, right? So that will affect the demand on your transportation network and the spatiotemporal demand of on your transportation network. But that's not something that I will be focusing on in this talk, right? So today it's about assuming that the social aspect is fixed, how can I optimize the operation of transportation system? That's the focus of this talk. All right. So I'm going to, there will be kind of two broad themes running through my talk. On one hand, I'll be talking about controlling transportation system at a macroscopic scale, okay? So think of ramp meter, routing, speed limit, traffic control, so things that are common control policies for the entire traffic stream, right? So that's what I call as macroscopic traffic control, right? That has to be contrasted with microscopic traffic control, where I would be interested in tweaking the car following behavior and the lane changing behavior of individual vehicles, right? So that's a microscopic control of traffic in the context of this talk. So there will be a microscopic and macroscopic aspect, and the other way of looking at the material is from an analysis perspective or control perspective, right? So a precursor to control is to analyze the performance of your system for a given set of parameters, for a given set of control policies, right? So that in turn is useful for planning purposes also. So throughout the talk, I'll be talking about both analysis and control at the macro and the microscopic level, right? So this will be kind of the structure, broad structure of the talk. So again, just to repeat, at the microscopic scale, what I would be interested in is understanding how different car following and lane changing behavior can impact useful performance metrics like capacity or throughput, travel time, energy, subject to safety, comfort, and mechanical constraints of the vehicles, right? So that's the high level structure. So clearly there are a lot of things that I want to talk about, and I need a framework, right? So I do not want to deal with problems on a piece-by-piece basis. I want an overarching framework within which I can make sense of the problem, right? So I can start formulating the problem and solving the problem. So clearly, there are other domains where I can take inspiration from, right? So if you think of, at a high level, if you look at a traffic system from a 30,000 feet perspective, where the size of the car is small, it looks like something like this. It looks like a communication system, right? So here is a small animation showing, very, very small animation showing what communication network would look like to a communication engineer, right? So you have these routers which are playing the role of, let's say, an intersection, and this red and blue, whatever, lines are packets, right? But if I didn't tell you this was a communication network, if I didn't say those were routers, you would not be wrong in being mistaken that maybe I'm even talking about urban traffic system here, right? So why am I bringing this up? Because this internet has been, although it's a recent development in transportation system, the communication networks and internet of today are very reliable. I mean, we reliably can browse the internet. There's a delay once in a while, but definitely not at the rate at which we face congestion delay when we go through urban transportation system, right? So there are algorithms, there are architectures, there are algorithms, there are optimization algorithms in the internet, and there is obviously some similarity, right, at least visually. So can I take some inspiration from here and borrow those ideas and see to what extent can I apply to urban traffic system? So yes, there are similarities, and in fact, this will be our starting point. But then as you start digging into the details, you soon realize that there are differences, right? So this is what an urban traffic system would look like, And I want you to compare, at least mentally, try to understand or try to distinguish between the internet and here. So there are several differences, right? So first of all, packets all have negligible size, right? Vehicles have size. They occupy some space, right? Packets, when they go from one router to another, they usually travel with the speed of light. There is no congestion when they go from one router to the another. Whereas in traffic system, vehicles cannot go instantaneously from one intersection to another. They have their own dynamics by which they move, right? And moreover, the dynamics of the vehicles are coupled. And if the vehicle in front of me is driving slowly, I have to drive slowly, right? So there are these dynamical aspects which are not present in communication networks, right? So they have to be taken into account when we design our control algorithms. So again, to summarize, there are in spite of the similarities, there are differences, right? So packets do not have dynamics, vehicle have dynamics. Packets do not occupy any space, vehicles occupy space, so you cannot store more than 20 vehicles in one block, right? So there is no conflict between heterogeneous flow. So what I mean by that is vehicular traffic has to avoid conflict with pedestrians. What that means that I cannot just give green for 5 seconds and immediately go 5 seconds to another street because pedestrians need to cross. So there are constraints on what kind of control actions I can take. And again, more importantly, packets do not have their choice in terms of what route they want to take, right? I mean, you program them and they will take their route. Whereas drivers, cars, at least right now, they have their choice. They can change their route choice at every intersection in general, right? So based on what condition they experience. So these are the differences. And therefore, even though we start our algorithmic ideas from this domain, we have to address these aspects when applying to traffic systems, right? So that's what I'm going to talk about today. So here are the four topics that I want to categorize my talk into. And there are four topics, but I'll be mostly focusing on the first topic. So the first half, I'll be talking about signalized arterial networks. And the second half, I'll be talking about freeway networks, right? So in arterial networks, in the first half, I'll be talking about novel evaluation and control methodologies for networks of intersections, right, at a macroscopic scale. And I'll be spending most of my time today just talking about the first topic. And then I'll zoom in into a single intersection level and try to start looking at the intersection between vehicles, right? Then I'll talk about freeway networks. Again, talk about how to parallelize computation of real-time control for freeway networks at a macroscopic scale. And I will end my talk with a discussion on how different car following behavior that would be made possible by autonomy could impact the capacity of freeways, right? So I'll provide some analytical tools to allow us to do those kind of calculations. Okay, so that's the outline of the talk. So again, as you see, there is a theme of micro versus macro running through the talk. Okay. Good. So let's start with the first topic, right? So here is an overview, right? So what I have, and again, it's best described using an animation. So here is a sample. Here is a part of Los Angeles downtown network near Staples Center. Okay. So the problem that I'm interested in are two, right? One is, given a traffic control schedule at each and every intersection, let's say something that I can get from signal timing charts, can I do some performance analysis at the network level, right? Can I know what will be the delay from point A to point B? Can I know how much energy will be consumed on an average by vehicles in going from point A to point B? So that's a performance analysis question, right? And I want to do that, so let me play this animation. So this, by the way, animations were done in a microscopic simulator called Visim, and I'll be showing a lot of animations in that simulator. So what we have here, what we did was we got information from timing charts from Los Angeles, LADOT, and we programmed the simulator with those values. And what I'm showing is just what Visim does in terms of simulating the movements of cars under those values, right? Now, from a performance analysis perspective, I want to know for example, in the long run, how many vehicles on an average pass through, let's say, this link? Is it 100 vehicles per hour, 200 vehicles per hour? And so I want this kind of quantities, because once I know those quantities, I can quantify congestion, I can quantify travel time, et cetera, right? Now, how would I go about doing those things? Meaning, for a given traffic signal control parameters, how would I know how many, what are the average number of cars passing through each and every link, right? The easiest way is what I'm doing right now here. Just run the simulations for a long time and just estimate from that. Now, there are, you could do that if you knew how to do this in VSim, okay? And my student Puyan, who made the simulations, will tell you it takes 2 to 3 years to just to set this. If you don't know this simulation, it takes 2 to 3 years just to learn how to do this, right? So there are challenges, right? So there are these microscopic traffic simulators, which, so what I want is a simpler approach to take traffic signal control parameters and do some calculations so that with high fidelity, I can get queue length estimations quickly without running these expensive simulations, right? Because simulations are expensive for multiple reasons, okay? I want to do that both under fixed time control, meaning when the traffic light schedule does not change with traffic, as well as when it could possibly change with traffic, right? So there's an emerging paradigm of adaptive traffic control or feedback-based traffic control, where the timings at the lights do not remain fixed. They're not time of the day traffic control parameters, but they could change based on the real-time measurements of queue length that you could get from loop detectors, right? So given a certain fixed policy or a given adaptive control policy, what's a quick way of for a traffic engineer to estimate what will be the queue length, right? So that's the parameter X, right? So that's the input, that's the X. In between is a box in which I could use a simulator or something else. And what I'm going to talk about is something else, right? So, and again, there are many softwares which will do this for you. But again, these softwares are commercial, they cost a lot of money, and it takes some time for you to get familiarized with that. So, and by the way, just a side note, that a majority of the intersections in the US right now run in this mode, about 90%, greater than 90% of the intersections. But thankfully, there is a growing realization to move from here to here to improve reliability of traffic systems, right? So if there's an accident because of which there's a change in traffic flow, this paradigm would allow the green lights to autonomously adapt their green times to the change in traffic flow conditions, right? So here is a sample section from a timing chart that's operating under fixed time control. So the key parameters are in a traffic control are cycle time, meaning how frequently do you revisit the same lane in terms of giving green. What's the offset? So the cycles start at different times. So the start point, start time of cycle for neighboring intersection has an offset for the green band maximization. So that's the offset value. And these values are just how much green is being given to different movements, right? So 21 seconds, 27 seconds, 27, 21, 27. So in a fixed time schedule, if there are four phases, you give 21 seconds, then 21, so that, then you switch to the phase four, then to phase six, then to phase eight, and then go back to phase two and just keep cycling it with the same fixed time, right? So that's a fixed time schedule. In an adaptive policy, these timings could change and the order could also change, right? So you have a lot more flexibility, okay? So good. So let's go back to our performance analysis question. So again, so the key, the message I want to say is, you could use your simulator, which depending on how accurate and how detailed you want to be in your simulation, could be quite. It's not easy to operate. It takes a lot of time for simulations to run, and of course you have to pay licensing fees, like thousands of dollars, for example, to be able to run the simulations. Whereas what I would like to show you is a model, right? It's a model that you can implement in, let's say, MATLAB, okay? Something that at least at USC all students have free access to. Right, and I want to show that they give the same output, essentially the same output from the perspective of performance analysis. Right, so that's what I want to show. So, what kind of models will I write here that I can code simply and get the same answer? Meaning, the answer from here and the answer from here is the same. Because if that's the case, then I would rather use this one, right, rather than this one. So that's the message. So the models are going to look something like this, okay? They are going to be based on differential equations, okay? Why differential equations? Because traffic has dynamics. So X here denotes, XI denotes the number of cars on link I at time t, right? So that's XI. So the rate of change, okay? So the number, when you go from one time instant to another, the difference in the queue length on link I is governed by two factors, right? So how many cars arrived in that time interval and how many cars left in that time interval, right? So that's the inflow and the outflow part of the equation, right? So so the equation is fairly simple. I mean, conceptually, it's fairly simple. It's just saying, it's just implying a conservation of mass, okay? What is not simple or what distinguishes one model from another is how do you model the outflow from a link? So in other words, what I'm saying is, if I tell you, give me a model for how many vehicles will leave from this link in the next, let's say, 1 minute, what kind of model would you use, right? So the more complex that model is, the better are your simulations, but then it takes, the models become more complex, right? So let me show you some of the challenges, right, in terms of modeling this outflow term. Because once you have this outflow term, this equation is completely defined, right? So because here are the external demands onto your system, which are given before you run your simulations. These are the turn ratios at the intersections, which again you get beforehand through surveys or some other means. What changes in real time are these outflows, because those have dynamics, right? As the traffic condition changes, the outflows change. For some 5 minute interval, you have 1,000 vehicle per hour outflow. For some other 5 minute interval, you could have just hundreds of vehicles per hour, right? So that's a term that has dynamics, and that's a term we want to model properly. So there are some key features that this term has to satisfy, right? So first of all, clearly if that link has red, right, there cannot be outflow from that link because it's red. Nothing can leave that link, right? So but at the same time, and when it's green, the outflow from that link, a simple model is that it should be equal to what is known as a saturated flow capacity, right? So these are the values that are you can read from highway capacity manual. So once I give a green to a through movement, what's the rate at which vehicles will be leaving from that link, right? So that's this value CI, okay? So at the minimum, it has to have this binary feature, right? When it's red, it has to be zero. When it is green, it has to be this CI value, right? But that's not sufficient. Because let's say a link is given green, but there is no vehicle on that link right now, right? Then there cannot be outflow. Outflow will be zero. So the outflow from a link cannot be independent of how many vehicles are present on that link right now. So there is a complex dependency, right? And there is a more precise way of writing that is shown here. So any realistic model has to capture this kind of discontinuous behavior. Okay. Now the problem with that is that it becomes very hard to kind of code this into MATLAB once you have this kind of discontinuous behavior, right? So what people have been doing so far is approximate, right? So how do they approximate? They forget about these constraints, okay? They forget about this, and also even forget that there is a green and red on and off kind of behavior. So let me just average out, right? So let's say if my total cycle time was, let's say, 60 seconds. Out of which 30 seconds was green and 30 seconds was red. And during green, let's say the flow, saturated flow was, let's say, 1,000 vehicle per hour. Then I'll approximate it by 500 and let it be green all the time, right? So that's a simple approximation now. Now you just circumvent all these difficulties and just replace by average, right? The problem with that, and if you go through calculations, is that it gives you spurious answers, right? Because you just cannot capture intra-cycle variations. So just to be more clear, when you run the microscopic simulation, which I was showing before, you have this periodic behavior that you see in your queue length profile, right? So the queue builds up when it's given red, and it then dies down when it's given green. But you do not observe this kind of behavior when you replace this your outflow with this approximation, with this simple approximation. So the idea is to capture this kind of behavior, because if you do not capture this behavior, then you cannot get a good performance evaluation, an accurate performance evaluation from your traffic system. Right. So the question is, is there a way to do this? So here is a very simple model. And again, I know there are equations. The first equation is just what I had from before. So the new part here is what is in the box. Right. So for those of you who I guess not used to optimization, this is a very simple optimization. Okay. Something that is known as a linear program. Okay. So again, our objective is, let's say I know the queue length on the different links right now, and what I want to compute is the outflow from every link. That's my problem. That's my objective. And what this linear program precisely does that for you, and at the same time, taking into account this on-off behavior, right? So it's making sure that the output that you get from this model will make sure that a link which is given red, the outflow will be zero, and the link which is empty will not have any outflow, right? So it takes into account all those complexities. So for the engineering friends of mine in the audience, the way you would implement this model in MATLAB is this part would be through OD45, and this part you would just get as a solution to a linear program, which again you can code in MATLAB, right? So compare this paradigm with a microsimulation paradigm, right? So in microsimulation, you had to learn how to use the microsimulation. You had to set the parameters and all of that. Here, you just code this up. That's it. Okay? And what I'm going to say is that what I'm going to now discuss in the next few slides is that, first of all, this model is well-posed, meaning if you put into MATLAB, the MATLAB will not crash, right? Because that's important. Because again, remember, there are discontinuities, right? I mean, the outflow becomes zero. It could go from zero to 1,000 and to capture the traffic behavior. So you want to make sure that when you start simulating it, it's giving you a believable answer, right? So in fact, that's what we show, is that in spite of all this crazy behavior from this model, which by the way is trying to capture the realistic traffic flow behavior, it has a nice solution, and in fact, it's consistent with microsimulations, right? So again, what that I'm illustrating with this plot here. So the blue lines, the blue error bar plots, are the output from VSim microsimulation, right? So over 20 runs, over one cycle, which was over 90 seconds, what I'm showing is one particular link. How did the queue length vary over that cycle, right? So it has this periodic behavior like this. And so blue is from the microsimulation, right, which took hours and hours for us to generate this. And then red is what we get from this model, right? And it matches, right? So, and there's a theory behind this. It's not just that it matches for one particular instance, but we have a nice guarantee that it will match, right? So if that's the case, then the claim is that, I mean, this is a good model for performance evaluation, right? So, good. So now I have translated from, let's say, from microsimulation world to MATLAB now, okay? Now, let's try to see if we can get more insights from this model, right? So let's say, implicitly, as I was describing this plot, I said if you let your simulations learn for a long time, you will start seeing this periodic behavior when you look at queue length versus time. So queue builds up, then it drops, it builds up, then it drops during red and green phases, right? So it achieves some kind of a periodic behavior, okay? And several researchers have actually established this analytically, that in fact you should expect such a periodic behavior. But the question is, now without running my simulations, even MATLAB simulations, can I predict what that periodic behavior would be? Okay, what the long run behavior would be? So again, let me backtrack, right? So far I have described to you a method by which you can start simulating your MATLAB from initial condition, you let it run, and your output will closely follow the micro simulation, right? What I'm asking now is, given that I know that in the long term, the behavior that I expect will be periodic, it will have some structure, can I compute that even faster without having to run through hours and hours of simulations even on MATLAB, right? So can I directly compute the steady state answer rather than going through the transient, right? Because the transient could be long, and I do not want to waste my computation resources in computing that transient, okay? So, and in fact, so we give an algorithm for that. And maybe in the interest of time, I'll just briefly mention the key idea or the challenges here, right? So the challenges, again, when you try to capture traffic flow dynamics accurately, you have to, you face this discontinuities and non-differentiability. What that means is that the queues can start decreasing suddenly because the red, you transition from red to green, so queues start building up or queue starts dissipating, and that is what makes all the computations hard, right? So hard to the extent that if you use standard techniques, which you might have learned in engineering classes, they will, no matter how much accurate you make your standard models, you cannot get a zero error if you use your conventional techniques. And again, if you know what Fourier series means, then that's what I'm talking about here, right? So I have a periodic signal, I want to approximate it, but so Fourier expansion is the natural way to think. But because of this non-differentiability features of your queue length trajectory, no matter how many terms you add, you will never get zero error. You will always have an error, right? So you need a technique which is tailored to this process, and hopefully we'll make sure that as you put in more and more computational resources, this error goes to zero. Right? So you need a new kind of an expansion or a new way of computing this trajectory, and that's what we compute, right? So, and the key idea here is the following, right? So the key idea here is, and let me illustrate that using this plot. So if my objective is to compute this red, okay? Let's take the example of just one link, very simple, right? If I do not know this red, but let's say somebody gave me this blue dot, that this blue, meaning at this time, let's say x equal time equal to 50, your queue is going to be empty. If I knew that, then I can just put in my MATLAB code using the model before, and I can just simulate to compute the entire trajectory, right? Because the code, MATLAB code that I had before, it allows me to simulate traffic flow dynamics starting from any initial condition, right? So here what I'm saying is, if my initial condition, I knew an initial condition on the periodic trajectory that I want to compute, then I know the entire trajectory because I can just plug into my MATLAB, just run it for 90-second simulation, I get the periodic trajectory. I don't have to go through the transient then, right? So the challenge here is you boil down the problem to computing this one point on your periodic trajectory. If you can find one point on your periodic trajectory, you are done, okay? And this point for us is, as I'm showing here, is going to be the time when the queue length goes from being non-empty to from being empty to being non-empty, when it transitions from being empty to being non-empty, right? So we give a very, I guess, nice procedure to compute this for a network, right? And I mean, over the next this few slides, a few bullet points, that is what that algorithm is describing, right? So. And so the key idea here is to realize that this point, this donut point that I want, always has to be at a point where the difference between the inflow and the capacity is positive. Okay, so I'm looking for a point where the queue length goes from empty to non-empty. Okay, it will happen that only if there is more inflow than outflow. Right, the inflow is the lambda term and the outflow is the C term, right? So you first try to look at those points where this guy transitions from negative to positive, because at that point, those are the candidate points at which the queue length will start becoming positive. Now it turns out that there are several such candidate points, and we give a very efficient way to search for the right point accurately, right? So again, the steps are you take your entire time interval from which you first find few candidate points at which you could have this blue donut point, and then we give a nice search algorithm to finalize that donut point, right? And once you have that, you have found a point on the periodic trajectory, and you just simulate using your MATLAB to find a periodic trajectory, right? So that is on the performance analysis side of things, right? So now what I've given you is a framework by which I give you traffic control parameters, simple MATLAB code. It will give you the queue length trajectories. Once you have queue length trajectories, you can compute delay and whatnot, right, from that one. Let's look at the control part now, right? So this was just passive performance analysis. Now let's say I want to control, meaning I want to determine what are the optimal green times, right, so that I optimize certain performance metric, okay? One performance metric is network capacity. What does that mean? That means that what are the possible external flows that can come into my system so that there is no gridlock, right? What's the maximum demand that my network can handle? Now that is dependent on many quantities, right? That depends upon the physical capacity of your network, how many lanes there are, what's the speed limit, and so on and so forth. But it also depends upon what green light schedule you are using at the intersections. Because if your green light schedule is very inefficient, you're going to have, even though there is space in the network, you're underutilizing the resources, right? So let's say what I want to do now is I have this notion of network capacity, which depends upon what control policy I'm using or what controllers I'm using at the intersection. How can I get this set as large as possible, right? So that I can have my network sustain as large number of demands as possible. So let's look at the fixed time control policy. Okay, something that is, by the way, I'm reminding you, is used in 90% of the intersections of the United States, right? So here is a visual representation of what this set would look like, right? So this is a two-dimensional plot. It says that any point here has two values, which, let's say, one value corresponds to inflow coming from one part of the network and the other value corresponding to other part of the network. So if I look at a point inside the boundary here, that means that that point can be sustained by my network, meaning there will be no gridlock, right? So the boundary is the region. So the set of points on the boundary are just at the point where gridlock is about to happen. So what I want is this set to be as large as possible, and the way I can enlarge this is by choosing the right controllers, right green light schedules. Okay, so I want to show you an animation where what you will see is that the network will initially start with this operating condition, okay, which is inside the capacity region, meaning there will be no roadblock, there will be no gridlock. But it's close to the capacity region, right? So there is not much slack. And then what you will see is that there will be an accident. One link will close down, which will cause this region to shift, because now the capacity region is different, right? So the point remains the same, but then the region moves. The set of feasible demand moves. So the operating condition means the set of demands become infeasible, and you will see a gridlock in that case, because that demand now, because of lane closure, is not sustainable anymore. Okay? So right now there is no incident yet, but I think this link is going to suffer an accident at some point, and then because of which this lane will be locked completely. Right? So right now there is no accident. If I let it play for a long time, you will see that it's becoming congested. Right? So you see congestion happening already, right? And now I don't know at what point the accident happens, but I'm going to just move it forward here. Sorry, the link was this one. This is the link which caused an accident. Okay, so you see no cars here because nobody's going in here anymore. So that lane is close to traffic now. Okay, so traffic, the same amount of traffic is coming from the outside of the network. Okay, that traffic was feasible before the accident happened, meaning before this link was taken out of service. But now, once this link is taken out, you see a gridlock here in this part of the network. Okay, so if you will see at the entry links, you will start seeing long queues forming there. So the message here is, and the message will continue, is that this phenomena, whether you have a gridlock or not after an incident, depends on what control or what green time policies you are using at the intersection. So what I'm going to show now is a simulation where same network parameters, same traffic conditions, same incident, but different controller at the intersection. Okay, so this is fixed time. What I saw was fixed time, meaning where the green light times do not respond to accident, right? They continue to give the game green time, same green time. So for example, if there's an accident here, they do give green time to this link, even though nobody wants to go here. So it's a wastage of resources, wastage of time, right? Whereas an adaptive policy will adapt, will sense it because it senses the through loop detectors, and it will respond. So what you will see is that you will not have this gridlock, okay? So on the left-hand side is what I just had showed you before. I'm just repeating here in the fixed time. And on the right-hand side is what the new policy, which is a specific adaptive control policy. Yes. So there's an incident. Okay. Same number of cars are trying to get into the network. Okay. But what is different between the left and right side is how the green times are changing in response to the changing traffic conditions. So they remain the same here, but they adapt here. And if you play it for a long time, what you will see is the left-hand side is a gridlock, which is what I showed before, but the right-hand side is still okay. Because the right side, the network capacity of the right side figure still enough to absorb the incident, okay? So just to show you the kind of impact that adaptive control policies can have in terms of mitigating incident. So then the question is, okay, so hopefully I convinced you that adaptive control policies are useful, right? But then what's the best one, right? There are so many ways in which we can respond to traffic. I showed you one, I've shown one here, but is this the best? Now, and this is where, again, I need to start making, I guess, my claim louder that, so this policy was inspired by communication networks. Okay, and in fact, in communication networks, if you search the literature, you will hear the word proportionally fair. Okay, so what we did here was just take the exactly same algorithm from internet congestion control and applied it to traffic, and we saw an improvement, right? Then the question is there any better? Now the internet world literature will tell you this is the best policy. You cannot get better throughput than this control policy. Okay, But that's when you analyze it for communication networks, where again, packets do not have dynamics, they do not occupy space, and so on and so forth. So we went ahead and see if this policy is so good. I mean, people have proven it to be the best policy for internet. How good is it for transportation work, right? So what I'm showing here are, and I'll go through this quickly, is this is what it should achieve if the transportation network did behave like communication network, right? This blue line. But what we see is the red line, okay? So, what I want to suggest here is that there are two effects that the micro simulations capture already, which are this lane changing effect, right? So when people want to, when they make a turn and enter a link and want to make a next turn, there's a lot of lateral movement, right? So in heavy congestion, that lateral movement also causes loss in capacity, which is not present in communication network. That is, in the simulations behind here, that's responsible for this gap, right? For what you hope, if you just blindly follow the communication network world, you would expect this, but what you get is eventually this. Right, so eventually run a bottleneck, no matter how good control policy you use, there's this lateral movement that will not just allow you to pump any more vehicles in the system. So streamlining is important at that point, right? And of course, the other issue is spillback, right? So in the communication world, they do not have to take into account the impact of increasing queue length on upstream or on the upstream intersections, because packets just occupy so little space that they're not going to interfere, that queue is not going to interfere with the upstream router. But here we have to, okay? Because again, more than 20, 30 vehicles, there is a spillback onto your upstream intersection. So that also causes a lot of gap, right? Very extreme gaps. So up to 50%. So this is the upper bound corresponding to the blue line that you would hope for if things behave like communication, but because of the spillback effect, what you eventually get is very low, okay? So there are two ways to read these numbers. Either your bounds are too optimistic, or you need to adapt your controller better to the transportation world, right? And we are working on both fronts right now to see if we can reduce this gap, okay? So again, this is one instance where you have to take into account the difference between transportation and communication networks. So I've been indicated that I'm running short of time, so I'll quickly go through a high-level overview of the remaining results, right? So as planned, this is the part where I wanted to spend a lot of time, because that's the part where I have a lot of details. But the rest of the talk anyway is at a high level, so I want to just go through it quickly, right? So remember, the models that I used in this part were macroscopic. They were not able to distinguish between one vehicle to another, right? So my models were in terms of queue length, how many cars are present. That was my variable, right? But when you start thinking about, let's say, intersection management in future, right, under let's say interaction between vehicles and infrastructure. So a vehicle is approaching an intersection, it wants to decide its speed based on how many, when it will get green, et cetera. You need to, queue length is not, because what does queue length mean, right? Queue length will just tell you how many vehicles are present on this link. They do not tell you the speed, the spacing between them, et cetera. It's a very simple variable. So the next topic, which I'm going to go through quickly, is we have a way to, we have a new way to analyze performance while taking those things into account at a microscopic level, right? So taking into account all those details. And the key message here, and probably this slide is a good way to say this message, is that in comparison to the state of the art, okay, so we looked at a state of the art, which consists of analytical models, meaning something that in those models you put in the traffic control parameters, the timings and the offset, and it will tell you in a closed form, like an expression for what should be the expected queue length or what should be the expected delay. If you look at all the existing models, you see that either they underestimate the queue or overestimate the queue, okay? So in some cases, this overestimation is just way off the chart, orders of magnitude overestimation. And again, because of the kind of approximations they make. So we come up with a new framework, which we call as vacation queue, which is able to accurately estimate meaning does not underestimate or overestimate. And it compares very well with empirical formula, which traffic engineers have been using all the time, right? So if this kind of formula, like Webster formula, for example, which have been the model of choice for performance evaluation of an intersection, we are able to get this formula from our analysis now, right? So now that you have a framework to get this formula, okay, you can now change, you play with that framework to have autonomous vehicles, etc., and already know what the new formula will look like, which you would not if you didn't know the underlying analysis, right? So we run simulations to make sure to check our model compares well with micro simulations under many scenarios, and there are nice fits, right? So in the remaining couple of minutes, what I want to briefly go through are our contributions for freeway networks. Okay, so imagine there's a traffic incident on, let's say, I-10, well, 110, okay, and it's a very busy freeway, and over the next 30 minutes, you as a traffic engineer want to decide. What should be the schedule of ramp meters, meaning what should be the timings between the greens? What should be the schedule of speed limits? How should you route vehicles so as to optimize the flow through this part of the network, or to optimize the travel time, right? So this is a humongous optimization problem for a large network. So what our contribution here is to provide a framework by which you can parallelize these computations, right? So instead of solving this huge problem, which you might have to solve every time there's an incident. You have to solve this huge problem for an entire freeway network. You could parallelize it over several processors, right? And the key idea here is, again, for those of you in the audience, there are two steps to this, okay? So first, we convert this complex optimization problem into something that that has a nice property, okay, called convexity. Okay, and again, for those of you who do not know what this means is, if your problem has this property, there are software tools which will solve this problem for you very fast. Okay, people have put in a lot of effort to solve this kind of problems. So our first contribution is to show that you can equivalently convert, meaning you transform a problem into this form, solve it in this form, okay, and then you can get back the solution to your original problem exactly. Okay, meaning you can get the ramp metering schedule, you can get the speed limit schedule, other things fast. But still, this is a centralized solution. So even though this is fast, but if the problem size is large, meaning the time horizon over which you want to determine the schedule or the number of the size of the network is large, this could take still long time, right? So our next contribution is, and I will not go through detail, is to parallelize, right? And you have to parallelize in the right way, meaning distribute the computations in the right way so that they give you the right solution. And it's not trivial to do that. So you have to be careful in how you pass the messages between different processors and all of that. So that's our contribution here, right? So I'll end with one topic where, so now this is a bit futuristic, going towards futuristic, right? So when you have autonomous vehicles and connected vehicles now, and imagine a hypothetical scenario where Uber or someone like Uber bought the right to provide mobility service in a city, right? So nobody owns a car, okay? It's a completely controlled environment. Uber has its own fleet of vehicles, and from Uber's perspective, it wants to know how should it program its vehicles with appropriate car following behavior, routing behavior, so that it optimizes quality of service, right? So it will let them run autonomously. There will be programs on the vehicle, so everything is decentralized. There are programs running on the vehicles which determine how do you change your speed in response to the vehicle in front of you, when to change lanes, etc., which route to take, so that overall the performance metric of your system is optimized, right? So the number of possibilities for what kind of behaviors you could program is huge, right? Just imagine how much, we all know the 3-second rule, right? But the lane changing rule is quite complicated, depends on the personality, even the car following behavior depends on the personality, and the autonomous behavior did not have to follow personality, right? You can program what you want it to be doing. So the possibilities are huge, and the number of possibilities will even increase if there's a communication between the vehicles. So do we have a framework by which, given a certain car following and lane changing behavior, I can quickly estimate what's the capacity or what's the delay that my system will have? Because if I could have that, then I could use that as an optimization module to come with optimal policies, right? And so here is a simple, so what we did was, and in the interest of time, I'll skip this. The summary here is that there's a neat analysis that is to be done here. Again, we start from communication network paradigm, but we quickly see the shortcomings of them, and then we extend them. So what we have is our analysis. What we did was we took a PEMS data, for example, and we plugged in a GM car following model, which is a well-known car following model, right? We chose the parameters which represent, I guess, typical car falling behavior by humans. We plugged in and we get the capacity. Our model tells the capacity should be somewhere in between. So this corresponds to 3-second rule, right? So this was a sanity check of our model. So this model then allows you to vary our framework, then allows you to plug in different car falling models, okay, to quickly come up with this estimate of capacity then. So it's a nice way to quickly do a performance analysis without extensive simulations to evaluate the performance under a given autonomous behavior, right? And again, there's some nice theory behind this, which I'm happy to talk offline, right? So let me conclude by saying, hopefully I gave the message that, there are advancements on two fronts, autonomy, like on the robotic side of things, and connectivity between the vehicles and the infrastructure, and within the infrastructure also, right? And each one of them has a potential to improve efficiency and reliability. And in particular, the infrastructure has already been happening. And again, in the conversations with cities, it's apparent. In spite of the similarities with communication systems, you have to be careful that there are differences. And once you start doing detailed analysis, they show up, right? The gap between the predictions from a communication system-based model and the actual performance that you get can be as large as 50%, right? So it's way off sometimes. So that makes the problem more interesting, right? So there are many more complexities in transportation system than communication system. So there's a huge opportunity for a lot of research to be done here. And at least in our work, the way we tried to tame this complexity was by looking at some scenarios. For example, looking at the emergent behavior, right? Looking at a large number of autonomous vehicles and trying to understand the capacity of that system, as I was showing later. Or trying to exploit the sparsity of the dynamics, like the traffic dynamics is, under traffic dynamics, you have coupling between only neighboring intersections. How can you exploit that to make your computations distributed in that manner? So there are, yes, there are complexities, but you can exploit this structure of your problem as well as look at particular regimes which are very informative to get meaningful answers, which you can then use for your simulations or if and then scenario, for example. That will give you a much more smarter way of I guess doing simulations or if and then analysis. Here are some sample publications. You can go to my website to see them. Talk to my students. Talk to me, or just send me an email. And I'm happy to answer questions. Thank you. So typically, when you look at signal timing sheets, the cycle time at intersections have very specific values, like 60 seconds, 90 seconds, 120 seconds. They're not arbitrary numbers yet, right? Let's say they're all 60 seconds, then if they're all 60 seconds at all intersections, that's my periodicity. I don't know if that's answer your question.
So, in order to play super scale between macro scale and hyperscale, the distance is the only parameter you have to
use. I see. So in fact, that's the thing that I was, that I did not explicitly say, but our model, for example, here does not capture spillback the way it's written. What that means is that this length proportions are not explicitly taken into account. Okay, we do take into account the time that it takes for vehicles to go from one intersection to another. That is taken, although it's not shown here, because I didn't want to complicate it further. But that is taken into account, and these results are under that. Allow that possibility, meaning allow vehicles to take some time to go from one intersection to another, but that time depends upon the speed limit and the length of the road. They allow that. Yes. So you still have this periodicity behavior there.
But it looks like linear, right? Suppose if you consider one block within like two intersections.
Yeah.
Sometimes like the distance will be it's not periodic, right?
That's fine. So distance do not have to be periodic. Distances can be arbitrary. That's fine. It's fine. Again, it is periodic with the same period, but then the amplitude, etc., may not be the same at different intersections. That will be determined by the length of the roads and all of that. But the period of periodicity is going to be the same. Yes.
Does this allow you to sort of quantify the loss of efficiency that's due to driver behaviors?
So we have some study loss, or even in fact gain in some cases. So we have our previous study, which I presented in my last Metron seminar 2 or 3 years ago. where we showed that if the drivers do not respond because they do not have real-time information, there's an accident downstream, but they do not have information, advanced information, then obviously that will lead to loss in efficiency because they're all trying to do. But at the same time, if let's say everybody had access to the same exact information, which leads all of them to take the same alternate route, even that leads to a loss efficiency.
Right.
So we came up with the right balance, like suggestions for the right balance between the two.
I was thinking more about, for example, lane changing.
Yeah.
You know, there's preferences about lane changing.
Yes.
There's preferences about around car following.
Yes.
So is there a way to sort of figure out how much impact
yes.
there is for different behaviors?
So our last the last one, so let me just go to some of the expressions here, right? So this, just as a summary, I went through this very quickly, but what the summary is saying, if you give me a car following behavior in a single lane, and if you tell me, okay, what's the maximum flow rate I can achieve from this system, naturally that will depend upon the car following behavior.
Right.
And let's say that parameter is this M. Now what is this M, right? As you increase M, you become more conservative in this car following behavior. So what this curve is showing is that as you become more conservative, the flow rate of your system starts decreasing. So we can compute these curves in closed form now. I mean, we don't even have to do simulations. But so right now, we can do this kind of calculations for homogeneous car population, meaning when all drivers are the same. But the natural next step is when they're heterogeneous. There's heterogeneity between the parameter M, let's say. But we have a framework already in place to quantify that sensitivity. Yes. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.